everyone, my name is Annie Filipova and I'm the Chief Operating Officer for Citi Treasury and Trade Solutions in Asia. Today, as part of the Female Entrepreneurs Worldwide Academy, I'm going to interview a fellow Citi banker. Angel,
hi,
good morning.
Good morning.
So happy to have you here for this interview. Can you tell us something more about you, about your life, and how did you become what you are today, a very successful woman?
First of all, thank you, Annie, for inviting me to this chat, right? Tell you a little bit about myself. I am the wife of my husband. I am the daughter of my mother. I'm friends and colleagues of, 4,200 people, in Citi. I see, that multiple roles, is kind of like common and, for every one of us. So it is actually important, for us to realize, those roles as well, on top, of what we have achieved in career.
We're going to talk about year 2020, which is a very challenging year in any aspect. There was 9 months since the pandemic started,
yes,
right? What changed operationally in the business?
What changed most, I think, is the consumer, okay, is the individuals in the society who consume, all different kinds of products and services. Because of the pandemic, people are much more health conscious. Because of the pandemic, people are very much open-minded, to digital solution, because they want to avoid, human interaction or, physical interaction. So there are a lot of customer behavior changes going on, in the community, which I think, as a business operator, as well as entrepreneur, we have to be very, very much, focusing on. That drives the business model change, that drives the needs of the business model change. So that's one part. And the other part is the staff in the organization, the behavior of them, the mentality of them also change, because they are facing the COVID challenge, mm-hmm, right? So how are you going to shape, the thinking as well as the business or the working model for the staff to fulfill, the ever-changing customer behavior, I think is one of the key challenge as well. So both of these actually drive how we change our operation. I don't think that, we just changed the operation because of COVID.
Yeah.
We changed the operation because, the customer behavior changed, because our staff behavior. Important. And this is the one thing that I learned, is that no matter what is going to change, your business model, your way of doing things, how you deal with your staff, your clients, we need to have empathy. We need to take people's perspectives for decision making, for communication, so that, we can move on. And I think, this is also very important for any business. It's not just banking. Any business who's dealing with a consumer, who's dealing with your customer, your partners, especially during crisis, you need to have the empathy. You need to have, the communication, the right level of communication. And you need to take in perspectives, so that, your business model and everything can be much more agile.
Great, great tips for everyone who is watching. That leads me to another question about operational resilience. Mm-hmm. There's so many, apart from COVID, the geopolitical events, and they're far-reaching, the effects are really different from before, right? They touch everybody. So what are your tips for companies? What do they have to do to weather these big changes that are happening?
Operation resilience. There is only one answer in my mind, is to put people first. Any organization, any company, any business, if you don't have people, you have nothing. And doesn't matter how stringent, you design your process, doesn't matter how detailed, you design your business model, mm-hmm, without people, in the organization, nobody's going to deliver that.
Yeah.
So during crisis, social unrest, political instability, COVID, whatever you name it, and in the past 18 months, that I experienced, I fully feel that without the the people. I mentioned about 4,200 people that we employed, you know, mm-hmm. in Hong Kong. Without them, you know, I don't think that we have a chance to weather through any of this.
And talking about people, can you share with us what are some of the initiatives and drives that you took to help employees to maintain their well-being, mental health during the last 9 months and actually the last 18 months in Hong Kong with all the turbulence?
There are several operating principles, you know, that I adhere to, you know, during that 18 months. First of all, I think, you know, during this period, you know, every one of us, including myself, feel a certain kind of insecurity because you don't know what happened next, right? And you don't know, you know, whether this is the right thing to do, this is the right thing to talk about. So there is a certain level of insecurity. So the first operating principle, you know, for me in dealing with the situations is honesty and transparency. So I don't know whether you feel that, you know, but I try to create a lot more conversation with the clients as well as with the employees. Create more forums, you know, so that people can raise the question, express their views. Mm-hmm. I think, you know, it is very important, you know, to bring honesty, you know, to the table. Tell them, you know, professionally, you know, what needs to be done, what can be done, what cannot be done. Personally, you know, I understand their perspective. I have empathy, you know, on what they're thinking, but, you know, what I demand of them, you know, in terms of delivering their job, right? So there are a lot of conversations going on, you know, until now. The other operating principle that I have is stick to the facts. We run a bank and we deal with, you know, numbers every day. We deal with a lot of data, you know, every day. And data don't lie, right? So this is also my motto, you know, whatever you talk about, you know, when you talk about COVID, okay, don't be scared, look at the number, okay? So I do not hesitate, you know, to share with all my staff how many COVID cases, you know, within the organization so that they know, you know, what they are dealing with. The work and life line got blurred. And I think, you know, that the next challenge, you know, for us is not so much the sense of insecurity of the working environment or the operating environment, but more so the mental health, you know, of the employee. Mm-hmm. Because when you have to deal with mental stress, you need your employee or coworkers to trust you, you know, to be able to tell you, you know, what are the stress that they are facing. But I think, you know, at the end of the day, you know, the motto, you know, of all these is that, you know, you have to put people first, and then you have to keep the honesty and integrity. And then, you know, you have to think of ways, you know, to kind of, you know, answer, you know, the needs. We tell people, you know, what is the percentage of work from home? We tell people, you know, what is the plan, you know, going forward? And if we cannot deliver that, we tell them why we cannot deliver that. You know, we have to retrench, you know, to work from home. Sorry about that.
I can say for myself, at any point of time, I felt very well informed. It's my personal opinion. If you want to be a successful chief executive officer, the first thing is you have to be a communications master. Because people actually look at the person and say, okay, the angel is calm, composed, she's smiling, she's telling us everything. Okay, that's good.
I think you mentioned a very good word, calm. Okay, this is usually,
calm,
you know, what people
important.
Tell me that, oh, you look calm because you're always smiling.
Yeah.
I said, yes, I'm calm, but not because I'm pretending, you know, that I'm calm. It's because I have that positivity in mind.
Exactly.
You know, when you have that positivity in mind, it shows, right? Yeah. And I always share with them that, do you know where I get that positivity? It's because of all of you.
Yeah, exactly. You
know, when I'm looking at people around me, you know, what I can see is capable people, very smart people, knowing what exactly that they need to do. If you can gain their respect, you know, and trust, I'm so confident, you know, that I don't need to roll up my sleeves and kind of tell you the instruction, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, before, you know, success comes. So that gives me the positivity, and that is a very good kind of interactive dynamic. You know, when I'm positive, you know, you are also having confidence in me, and I'm seeing more positivity from the group, and it's very good, you know, interactive dynamic.
Absolutely. If you are positive, the chances you get positive back are much higher than you if you come out negative and hope to get positive response.
But very importantly though, you know, I also find out that I should and I can tell myself, you know, that I can show my vulnerability at times, you know, because, you know, if I don't know, I don't know.
Yeah, you don't know, absolutely.
If I need help, I need help. Talk about gender. I think this is one of the probably key difference, you know, between a male leader and a female leader. And I'm very conscious, you know, that as a female leader, I don't need to live up to an expectation of a male leader, okay?
Absolutely.
So if I'm vulnerable, I'm vulnerable. You know, if I want to cry, I cry. I can't help. So I think, you know, to some extent, you know, leadership is not about style. You know, whether you have a male style, you have a more masculine or feminine style, it doesn't matter. I think leadership is about quality. You know, you need to have the right leadership quality to lead the organization at the time that the organization needs.
Work from home is now a normal way of working. It was not like this, and Asia was behind America and Europe, where working from home was normal. As you mentioned, right, there's so many challenges at home. Is this really the future way of work?
The world is changing so fast. You know, the operating environments, you know, the customer needs are changing so fast, which call for, you know, agility and flexibility of both, you know, the organization as well as the employer. Be able to prepare ourselves for that. Two things, I think. You know, first of all, we need to treat our staff, you know, differently. In the past, I think many corporations will be very much focused on productivity. Productivity means, you know, you every day, you know, you see your staff sitting there, working, delivering work, and then you measure, you know, the outcome and the work. Not that they don't trust them, you know, but I think, you know, they trust what they're seeing. I think in the future, because of the flexibility, you know, that the industry demand and the society demand, I think to a certain extent, you know, the employer needs to entrust people more, entrust, you know, the employee, entrust the colleagues a little bit more. Focus on the outcome rather than the process more. You can still measure the deliverables. You can still measure the outcome, right? But you don't really have to mandate, you know, the outcome to be delivered and to be manufactured within the 8 hours, you know, that the staff is sitting there, right? Number two, I think, you know, I talked about agility. You know, I think, you know, we all need to change, you know, and develop ourselves faster, okay? As a company, or as an owner, you know, we need to think about, is my business model, you know, still relevant, not from a selfish perspective, because, you know, talking about entrepreneur, I'm sure that a lot of entrepreneurs, when they first established the business, they have their own passion and they have their own mindsets, you know, that this is what I want, right? But, you know, if you want to run a sustainable business, you need to ask yourself a question every day, that whatever that we are doing, is it still relevant, you know, to our target audience? So it is not about what you want. It is about what your customer wants, right? So I think, you know, we need to be prepared, you know, to make changes, you know, to be the change leader, you know, to be a change agent, you know, in order for the business model to survive, in order for the business to thrive. As, you know, for the employee, I think, you know, they also need to prepare themselves to progress, you know, with the environment. Many of us, you know, think about, you know, how long our job will last. especially, you know, for, you know, in a bank, you know, that there are many people working in the operation. And there are jobs, you know, that will be eliminated. So as an individual, you know, we need to upskill ourselves. You know, we need to stay relevant. And by staying relevant, you know, we need to learn new things.
Yes, curiosity is what keeps us basically moving forward. Thank you, Angel. Thank you so much. And I hope our spectators have learned a lot today.
Hope you enjoy this episode brought by our corporate partner Hubs, a premium women's fashion brand. If you want to join us, just visit few.community and subscribe to our channel if you haven't done that already.